by a group of students in the GC2Y, Sex and Resistance, as well as the GC Women's Center and LGBTQ plus programs. So our advocacy group is going to start by introducing ourselves. I'm Carla.
I'm Dominique.
I'm Olivia.
I'm Sierra.
I'm Zanette.
And to lead
I'm Caroline.
Sorry. Okay, and to lead into the Dr. Pilcher segment on gender and film, we're going to start firstly by giving some background information on gender identity and expectations.
So gender is someone's internal sense of who they are. It's a social construct as well as the expectations that are tied to it. For example, society expects boys to be tough while girls are painted as nurturing. Gender is different from sex, which is more biological. Gender is also often confused with sexual orientation, but we can remember that gender identity is the sense of oneself, while sexual orientation is who you are physically and or emotionally attracted to.
For a long time, at least in Western society, gender has been seen as binary, boy, girl, or man, woman. However, these gender is a social construct. It isn't really as black and white as it may seem, and it is actually more of a spectrum, especially when one takes into consideration that human individuality does not fit into boxes.
One of the reasons that we named our event More Than Blue or Pink is because we think it's important to recognize that we are more complex than the gender expectations of us. While we are more than our gender identity, gender expectations are still controlling forces in our society. So it's important that we are aware of them and respectful of how people identify.
While gender expectations affect cisgender people, those whose sex assigned birth aligns with their gender identity, they struggle with it, but it also affects transgender people who do not feel like the sex that they were assigned at birth aligns with their identity. Mainstream images of gender, for example, seeing a person who identifies as non-binary as strictly genderless or androgynous can be harmful. While a non-binary person can be someone who's androgynous, it can also be someone who just doesn't identify with the binary. They don't have to be seen as someone who is genderless. They can be gender fluid or gender queer. It doesn't mean that they have certain physical characteristics tied to their identity, because again, gender and expectations are a social construct.
Similarly, in the media, transgender people are commonly depicted as cross-dressers or drag queens, which has more to do with gender expression than gender identity. This misrepresentation is harmful and can negatively affect trans people's mental health. When transgender people are denied things like their proper pronouns, respect, and are told by society that they are not real men or real women, or that their identity doesn't exist in the case of non-binary people, this causes harm. Their circumstances influenced by gender expectations are one of the causes of transgender people being at a higher risk of depression, anxiety, and suicidal thoughts. And it is one of the many reasons why it's crucially important to support and respect people of different gender identities. Now that we have a foundation of gender, we'll hand it over to Dr. Pilsner, who will talk more about gender in film.
All right, thank you all so much for that intro and context and for having me. So I appreciate that. And let me share my screen real quick with y'all. I got some slides I'm gonna use here. All right, to jump in with that great introduction about gender identity, I want to put this in context with film and popular images. So that's my area of study, but it's also an important area where we're seeing representation. We have obviously for a long time seen representation of gender. And as society shifts in how we think about it, we see some of those shifts in film and popular images. So a little refresher, and y'all covered some of this, some terms that you want to know, basic terms to help us here to understand what's going on. Gender is a term that refers to the social norms, the behaviors, roles associated with men and women. And as y'all said just a few minutes ago, That's been thought about in binary terms, that masculinity is associated with men and boys and femininity is associated with women and girls, and that they're polar opposites, and that there's a hierarchy associated with that too, masculinity being valued more than femininity, one being more active, one being more passive, in traditional constructions. These associations are socially constructed. Masculinity is socially constructed, and then linking it to men and boys exclusively is a social construction. It has shifted over time, what counts as masculine and what men should be like. So it's by no means absolute. Another important term, similar, but thinking about adding another layer to that, gender identity. And gender identity is an individual's internal understanding of their gender, and its relationship to man or woman, and however they conceptualize that. So that is definitely focused on the individual and how they experience, understand, express their gender. And the other term that was also already referenced is assigned sex. So that's a label of male or female that's assigned by doctors before or at birth based on genitals or chromosomes. And there's complications even with thinking about assigned sex, especially when you think about intersex folks. So it's by no means a stable ground either, but that's sort of another term that we need to have and something to think about as we're figuring out what this looks like in film and media. All right, just some last few little terms here. Gender identities, and again, some of these were covered. Cisgender refers to when someone's gender corresponds to their assigned sex, whereas transgender would be gender differs from the assigned sex for that person. Non-binary or genderqueer would be gender is not exclusively masculine or feminine, and it's not associated exclusively with either man or woman. So that person identifies outside of that binary or in a fluid relationship to it, depending on what that looks like for the individual. And then agender being someone who identifies with no or an unknown or sort of lack of gender. All right, so those are key terms there. Let's think about this in popular images for a second. So photographic images, been around for quite some time at this point. End of the 1800s, that's when it really kicks off. Photographic images depict gender and gender identity visually with actual people. So they capture bodily appearances, clothing, gestures, behaviors, roles, and that's sort of unique to the medium in that it captures that visually in that photographic way. So this does bear some similarity to how we see and interpret gender in the world around us, because we encounter people visually for their eyes and we interpret and read it that way. So the medium has some relationship to that, but definitely want to remember that images of gender are ultimately representations. They're not realities. They're constructed. The real people that are included, even if it's documentary, and they're constructed by someone who created it. So they're characters and narratives, especially in those fiction films, but even in something like a documentary, it's only capturing people in a particular way. Usually some sort of money is involved, or it's trying to make money, or there's an artistic goal. So even if it looks, and especially when we think about digital images and our social media and things like that, when we capture those images, they're not whole recreations of who we are as people. And people are much more complex. And people's gender identity is much more complex. The creators of the images as well live in particular social and historical contexts and belong to a certain moment. They're thinking about representing things according to the values and ways of perceiving things at that time. And last thing that we wanna kind of throw out there that's really important, and y'all kind of touched on it, historically, especially if you think about Hollywood and mainstream films and media, gender has been linked visually to sexuality. So certain displays or certain gender expressions, gender identities have been linked to either normal or abnormal sexuality. When in reality, as y'all kind of said, those things are separate. Your sexuality being sexual desire, who you're attracted to, that kind of thing, and not being separate from gender. But if we're thinking about how they've been represented represented visually in film and media and television and whatnot, there hasn't been a link there. That's something that we're gonna get into a little bit more in a second. All right, so why think about all this? Even though images are not perfect, they're not reality, they are important to analyze. One, they're really popular in our culture, and they're a way that we understand and communicate and learn things and share things. And so that's huge. And if we do engage with them as we consume them, watch them, they can do a variety of things, or we can do a variety of things with them. They can show us how we as a society think and have thought about gender and gender identity. You could say societies. I'm sort of thinking about it here in a US context, but they show us how societies have thought about gender, gender identity. They can reveal or expose gender inequality and injustice, and shed a light on that, and critique that potentially. They can also represent marginalized gender identities and experience, shed light, bring visibility to groups that have not been shown well. And they can facilitate new ways to perceive and imagine gender and gender identity. So that's that last one there is moving away from sort of thinking about are films and images realistic to what can they do that we can't necessarily do in our real world? How can they imagine things and show us things in different ways? All right. Yeah. So from here, what I'm going to do is show you all some examples of how we examples of some films, three films, and how we could sort of pick apart gender and gender identity in them, what they sort of offer us if we're thinking about, like I just said, this list of things that that we can glean from films and images. All right, so Vertigo, Gender in Vertigo. Vertigo is a 1958 film directed by Alfred Hitchcock. I'm going to show you a little scene from it and follow up with it once we've watched it. It's not too long. But yeah, think about what's going on here with gender as you're watching this, masculinity, femininity, particularly, just yeah, see what you think. Definitely like shout out if something's off with the sound. I think we should be good, but hopefully we don't have anything mess up here. Give me one sec. Sorry about that. All right. So, where to go? As you can kind of see in this scene, there's a valuing of traditional masculinity and femininity for white men and women. That's sort of the focus of the scene. So, the character's gender, same as the same sex. We see a blonde woman in a dress. The first thing we see is her back and her sort of body shown to us before you see her face. Her skin is somewhat exposed, and she's sort of a passive recipient of this man who Jimmy Stewart is playing, looking at her. And the camera and the audience sort of look with him, or kind of aligned with him as he turns to look, notices her, whatnot. So pretty traditional in that sense. He is also pretty traditional in terms of masculinity. He has on a suit, he's drinking at the bar, he has a dark liquor of some sort, versus like something that might be seen as more feminine. He's actively looking at this beautiful woman, or who's being sort of framed as a beautiful woman, and the audience is sort of aligned with him and his perspective. We can already kind of see just how it's visually arranged here, that he's the hero and the main character, and that something's gonna go down between the two of them. And another key part of this scene here is that the traditional gender, masculinity and femininity is going on here, is there to also signify that there's some sort of heterosexual desire, attraction going on. So the sort of traditional gender is sort of inspiring that they're linked together in this sort of scene. And the audience is sort of invited into this moment and invested in the intimacy of it for those various reasons, the gender and what it's saying about attraction. All right, so kind of classic Hollywood example there. Moving forward though, later example. So Boys Don't Cry is a film, an independent film that did really well, that stars Hilary Swank, who won an Academy Award for her role in this film. It's from 1999, directed by Kimberly Pierce. So this film, obviously gonna be a bit different than Vertigo. I'm actually gonna have to exit my PowerPoint or slides here for a second to pull it up for y'all. Same thing, think about what's going on with gender in this scene. I'll show you the very opening scene of this film. All right, here we go.
Shorter. That is short enough. Okay, superstar. What's with the shirt? That is the most frightening thing I've ever seen in my life. It's like a deformity.
I'll fix that.
That's better. If he was a guy, I might even want to fuck you.
You mean if you was a guy, you might even want to fuck me.
So you're a boy. Now what? Come on. No fucking way. The joke is joking.
Come on, don't be a pussy. Ow.
It's a pussy. Let's go home.
You decide.
You've got a day.
I gotta go.
Can I talk to you just for a minute?
Oh my God. I'm back.
The sides back up real quick. All right, so different kind of thing going on here. We see this scene representing a marginalized gender identity. Obviously some things have shifted since from 1958 to 1999 in terms of how we're thinking about gender identity, sexuality, even though this is one of the first films to represent a transgender person. So we see that here. We still see the traditional characteristics of a white masculinity here, the short hair, the cowboy hat and clothing, but here they don't align with the assigned sex of the character. And that's part of what is being sort of explored, explained, engaged with in this scene. Gender identity is also represented more explicitly. So we're getting some exploration of Brandon's internal sense of his gender and its relationship to boy or man. And the status with that. you could still see, though, and it's something to think about, do we still see gender as a binary and a hierarchy still at play? So we still see some like thinking about gender correlating with genitals or sort of like the mimicking of that. We sort of see this sort of like boy, are boys better than men? And some sort of engagement with kind of slurs aimed at women that are engaged. So the masculinity, what's going on with there and how it's being thought about in binary terms is still at play in some ways. And if we think about this as well, gender here is still linked in some ways to romantic and sexual desire. Brandon's getting ready to go on a date. And so we still have that something about sort of, yeah, his gender identity is communicating something about his sexuality, the way that it's represented here. All right, my last example of a film, and I'm working all with films here. There's a lot of stuff going on in TV and other places, and this certainly could be thought about there as well. But I'm working with film here. So last little clip here I want to show you. This is from a film called They from 2017. I'm going to show you just a little short clip of it.
All right. Have a good time.
Jim.
Is that Jay? Hey.
Hey.
Hey, how's it going?
Fine. I think it's stuck.
No, it's a shame. Oh, I really need to change this. Mine was also like this. I took it to George's dad's store.
So you and George hang out together?
No, why? Aren't you in the same class? I'm in his class, but I just go to his dad's store. We're not friends.
Oh, your dress.
I'm going to a party later.
No, I mean you left the stain on it.
I should get going. This should work now.
Thanks.
Jay?
Yeah?
Where were you? I thought you were in your room.
I went to get some bowls from Nora.
Okay, we're making breakfast.
I'll be later. I have some stuff to do.
In this scene here, what we see is a disruption of gender expectations to visualize a non-binary character, non-binary gender identity. Jay, who's representing the scene, expresses characteristics of both traditional masculinity and femininity. And these expressions, their expressions don't neatly signify boy or girl. And the little notes there, you saw at the end, that last little sheet of paper. Each day, Jay also writes down whether they feel more like a girl or a boy, because people outside, like other people, are sort of putting pressure on Jay to, quote, pick a gender. And you can already sort of see it in the scene that other people interpret and respond to Jay with these traditional gender expectations, with the dress and the idea that you don't want to get the dress dirty, and sort of the whole interaction going on with the sort of bike as well. So this you can see is affecting and shaping Jay's sense of their gender, gender identity. And so if we're thinking about what this film, this scene might offer us, Does it have a new way of sort of perceiving or imagining gender, or at least something that's different from films before or changing as time has passed? So what we see here is that gender isn't linked to desire or attraction to someone else, and it's not being linked to sort of genitals, to use right sort of term for it. It is focusing rather on someone who's younger and learning how to express themselves with gender, and how we use gender to, it's focusing on how we use gender to relate to others, what's possible, what's also hindered or limited in that process, if that makes sense. And as we see in all these examples, I wanted to throw this in there, we still have all white characters in these examples. So I think that's something to think about too, in terms of race often characterizes what gender looks like for a particular character, what's traditional, what's not, and what's possible if we're thinking about different kinds of experiences being represented in terms of gender and gender identity. Those are three sort of examples of what's going on in films. Like I said, it applies outside of that to other TV and media. So it's a really important thing to look at and analyze, can give us a lot to work with. If we can remind ourselves that there are representations that can be productive and beneficial, but that we need to analyze and see what the possibilities and limits are, and really what we need to do and think about in the future of what we want out of such representations of gender and gender identity. So that's all I have for y'all. I'll unshare my screen. Sorry, now the sun is like totally in my eyes, but I guess it's like question time. You all have any questions for me? I didn't really see the chat or anything, so I feel like I was just talking at y'all, but sure, go for it.
I just want to know, like, what got you interested in film?
What got me interested in film? Honestly, just watching films, the experience of watching them, the visual components of it and the analysis of it, like studying it, learning about it, and the ways that it communicates to us in differently than, say, reading something or literature in a more written text-based sense. The experience of like what it's like to watch a movie is a huge part of it, like just experiencing visual. So that answers your question.
I have a question too.
Okay.
So I feel like so much of our lives is gendered, like things around us. So what can we do you think, to like lessen that so that we don't see it so much as like such a strict thing that we have to follow?
That's tough. Yeah. It's like you said, it's not something like it's all around us and people are doing it in their own ways and some better or worse than others, I think, and expecting other people to look just like them or whatnot. And so it's hard to like escape from it, even if you wanted to, fully escape from it. But I think, learning yourself and expressing yourself and trying to just surround yourself with people that allow you to figure out who you are in a like loving, compassionate way, I think is a huge part of that. And whatever really works for you, if it means thinking more about the concepts, watching more stuff, hearing from other people. So I can't really give you a set sort of rule to do, but that would be sort of part of it. Just like figuring out what it is for you and taking care of yourself and as you're in that process and having a good support group of folks, if that makes sense.
You like by no means have to answer this question, but I was wondering, like, obviously, like coming out as transgender probably might have been was like a huge step in your life. And I'm just wondering, like, when like you knew and like when you felt comfortable in your own skin. And I don't mean like any of that in like an offensive way.
Yeah. I guess I can only speak for me in the situation. It's a process. It was certainly a process for me. I certainly didn't come from a background where a really open family background or like any of that. So it took a lot for me, a lot of thinking through things that I thought were true and kind of taking them apart and learning that they were actually one, not that absolute and true, and that it was harming me to think that was the case. Like when you think, if you're coming from an environment where you think these are the only options, or that option might be there, but it's really bad and I shouldn't pursue that option, or if that makes any sense. So it takes, like, for me, it took a lot of questioning concepts, questioning what I thought was true to understand better who I was. And then just be, you know, like growing in time, more comfortable with myself and expressing myself with other people, if that makes sense. Maybe that sounds like broad and vague, but it certainly didn't happen overnight, I guess, is the answer to that.
I mean, I feel like that makes sense. I feel like when you get to college, like in high school, like people are kind of like insecure about who they are in a way, but then when you get to college, like everyone does their own thing and like no one cares. So I think that, like, in a sense, like you can relate other types of like growth to that, like kind of in like a linear but not linear way.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it happens in tandem with other things that are going on, and like getting older and like being in different kinds of environments and around different people and different things like that. So it doesn't happen just like, it's happening in relation to other kinds of growth that are going on in your life, I would think. So.
Also, like, anyone is welcome to ask questions. Like, if you're in the audience, you can ask questions on Facebook. You can ask questions here. Don't be shy. We're all the same. It's fine. but if there are no questions, we'll wait like a little bit, but we can conclude.
This one is it's kind of a question that was posed earlier when we were presenting in class, but Dr. S mentioned, she showed us a video where a trans actress, I think, she was talking about how representation for her means safety. And in your opinion, like, do you think that all representation is good representation so that it can equal safety? And two, if not, then what do you think that we can do kind of to help it, to help get the better representation out there?
Yeah. I don't think that all representation is good representation necessarily. I think that we've seen, not just with gender, but if we think about like Hollywood and mainstream kinds of media, stereotypes of groups, othering of groups in ways that have been really harmful. And I think that continues today. And I think that still goes on with gender. So as far as how do we change that? How do we ask for sort of more from our representations? I think that we're seeing a really, in a lot of ways, thanks to the internet and social media, people who view things speak out and share what they want and what they think is not okay. And I think that has been really important, will continue to be really important to have that, to speak up about that. I also think personally, my kind of view on what we need in terms of representations, I don't totally buy into like positive representations fully, because a lot of times when you just think about a more positive representation, who decides what that means, and who can say for sure if something is positive now, if it will be. And a lot of times people will make something, like if we think about companies or something, for example, of like, or I don't know, the Oscars making things more positive or inclusive, but they're doing it for like motives that might not necessarily be actually changing structural things that have hindered people from being represented and creating their own representations. I think that we need to continue to push sort of the media making industries, from film to, you know, the big tech companies now with social media and stuff, to diversify in real ways. People create content, the types of content that are created, and just the types of representations. I don't think the safer gender, that the ultimate best goal is to say, let's have the most realistic representation of gender possible. I don't think that's possible, but it would be great if we had, like, if you even just think about trans characters, if you had trans characters that appeared in everything from rom-coms to horror movies to documentaries, like, there's a lot to be done, and I think we can diversify that content So that maybe was a long answer to your question, but that's, I guess, a little slice of what I think about that issue.
Okay, so we do have a Zoom comment. Someone commented, I know it must be hard to pick your favorite films. Do you have any favorite directors whose work you always look forward to and excited to see what they do next?
That's a good question. Let's see. Yeah, it's hard to have favorites. I have films that have been really important, and it's weird because they'll change over time. Like, I might have really liked them at one point, and then later it's like, do I have a different relationship to that film? Let's see, favorite directors though. I don't know if I have favorite directors as much as like films that I really like. Like, I like the 80s film Desert Hearts a ton. I like the film, I think Dr. Schwartz is on here, but we've talked about it. Personal Best is also a really good film. I don't know if I have a director. I do like one of the indie directors that does kind of like more very minimal poetic kinds of films, Kelly Reichert, a lot. But yeah, I wouldn't say I have like one director that I sort of turn to. I also like Star Wars and stuff that, like, just popular stuff too. So if that kind of answers that question.
The second question is, what advice would you give to authors who want to be more inclusive in their writing?
So authors want to be more inclusive in their writing, just like in general kind of writing, creative writing. Whoever asked the question want to specify creative. That's a really interesting to think about. I guess I'll think about it kind of what I would sort of say for a film as well. I think representation and being inclusive is not just about adding more people and different kinds of experiences to what you're writing about or representing, I guess, in film, but it also is challenging your own perspective and where you're coming from. I was going to say this when we were looking at the scenes, but a thing that you'll sort of notice, even in Boys Don't Cry and They, even though both of those films are pushing back against that more traditional stuff in Vertigo, we don't really see either of them kind of fully align the camera and the audience's gaze with that person who has a more marginal gender identity. We're still kind of looking at them. Whereas we get the sense then Jimmy Stewart's character in Vertigo that we're with him, like we're aligned with him. So it's also a matter of like, how can we change society's sort of perceptions and perspectives on things? So it's not so much like, let's add a more diverse cast of characters as much as like, let's shift and rethink about how we come to view something, if that makes sense, and whose views we're seeing. So I guess in terms of creative writing, thinking about point of view and perspective in that way, seeing things in new ways, in different ways, and ways that are challenging sort of normative ways of seeing things. If that makes sense.
There was a question on Facebook from Scott Butler. He said, great lecture. I really like Boys Don't Cry. Do you think she would get pushback today for playing that role, assuming she is cis and not trans?
I definitely think there would be pushback against that role today. And I think that there's been pushback of that film against that film for that more recently as well. And then also retorts from other people being like, well, it was the first film. Should you held it to that standard? So absolutely. I think today when we think about, the characters that are being cast, because we have this history of for transgender folks, like not representing transgender people. And then we have the first sort of representation like Boys Don't Cry, not using a trans person, just seems like another slap in the face of like, well, you haven't done this for decades and decades. And now that you have the opportunity, take that extra step to sort of do that. And I think that's something that would come up today, and it comes up with other films. I don't think I give sort of a final answer on that. I know that Kimberly Pierce at the time sort of was like, well, it's difficult because we didn't have, that many trans people working in the industry, which is another problem also. So, but yeah, I think the film would have a different sort of reception in that regard today. It would be interesting to see what would happen if they tried to make it today, for sure.
It's kind of the same when like movies are whitewashed, like when they wanted to cast like Mulan with white people. It's like, did you not see the Disney movie? Like,
and it's really what it's doing is it's like still setting up the like marginalized groups as others, like, oh, like a normal person can just like play the other by doing this thing. And they do it really well. They can get an Academy Award for doing it. And usually, it's done in a reductive sort of way, for sure.
So Mrs. Sevick asked, do you have any favorites/recs in terms of television?
Television, Rex in terms of TV, just like in general, or like if we're thinking about gender, representations of gender, if you want to chime in, representation of gender. I really depends on, I think, what you're sort of looking for. I know I was talking with my class yesterday, we were talking about Unbelievable, the show. That one's pretty intense, but it kind of deals with gender and true crime genre in interesting ways. I also like, I was thinking about it, it's a few years old now. There's a series called I Love Dick. I still don't know what I think about it. Kevin Bacon is in it, but it was interesting. And it's on Amazon, it was worth seeing, but yeah, I still don't know what I think about it. But there's some interesting exploration of gender throughout that, and sexuality in there too. Let's see, what else in terms of gender? Any other people can throw out recs too if you've seen something that's in line with this. Let's see.
Zanette, you said that you were watching a movie, a show that you liked, right?
I was just about to say that. I highly recommend Pose. It's on Netflix. Nice. It I don't know if you've ever seen it, but I could go on about that show. I really love it.
I've heard great things about it. Yeah. And people say that. Yeah, that's
it. Yeah, and it's a good series if you want to explore the intersectionality between gender stereotypes and race, because almost all of the characters in the show are Black or Latinx. So I think it's very good, actually.
All right. Do we have any more questions? In the Facebook Live, I think Dominique.
There are no more questions on Facebook either.
All right. So, should we give it a minute?
I just wanted to say thank you for taking your time to help us with our project and just kind of exploring your topic with us. I know that like I learned a lot. I had no idea like how many different genders there were. I didn't know really like the best way to be an ally. So I just appreciate your time.
You're welcome. Thank you all. This was great. Yeah, I really appreciate y'all putting this together, for sure.